Amen. Let's get right to the word this morning. And I want to say it's such a pleasure to be here again. I count it a privilege every time we're together. Amen. I want to make a quick announcement before we turn to our opening scripture. I just want to remind everybody that the men's meeting is coming up. We're leaving this Friday morning. We'll be traveling down together. So there's a meeting going to take place immediately after this morning service. So if you're signed up and planning to go to the men's meeting, please meet Brother Doug Hatfield. He's going to conduct the meeting for me. He's got all the details. Brother Doug Hatfield over in the foyer of the old sanctuary. So if you just go down the hallway and meet him over there, and he'll give you all the details for that. So please remember that immediately after service. Also, I want to say we had a really good time this weekend at meetings at True Word Tabernacle. Who had an opportunity to go Friday or Saturday? What a blessing that was. It was just a privilege. And Brother Ron has such a gift of bringing, he has a gift of just raising your faith, but it's not that. He has a gift of challenging your faith to where you can say, whoa, what am I doing with the word, right? And then you recognize, hey, there's a whole lot more to this than what I've been applying. And so I was really thankful for that. We had a really good time there and appreciate that very much. Also, I got a chance to talk to Brother Dwayne Lawson, and he's actually going to be home this week. So that means he's going to be preaching here Wednesday night. So we've tried to make that work out for a long time, and every time I talk to him, he's out of the country, or he's in the East Coast and West Coast or in Canada. But he happened to be here, so it's going to work out. And then Sunday, while I'm with the men at the men's meeting, Brother Brian Locke is coming in to visit his family, so Brother Brian Locke's going to take the Sunday service for us. So that was just really good timing, and so we really are excited to have him here also. So that's wonderful. We're looking forward to those times. Amen. Let's take our Bibles and turn to Isaiah chapter 61. We'll read a portion of Scripture. While you're turning there, I want to just make one more announcement. Communion would normally be this Sunday, which is the 1st of November, but we're going to have 14 of the brothers, myself, and two deacons are going to be at the men's meeting. So I decided to move it back 1 week, so we're going to move it to the 8th of November. So in this month of November, we won't have communion on the first Sunday. It'll be the second Sunday. So we'll announce that again Wednesday and also next Sunday. So please be aware of that. All right, Isaiah 61, verse 10 and verse 11. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness. As a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with jewels. Amen. Let's read that again. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God. I will greatly rejoice and my soul shall be joyful. Why? Because he hath clothed me in garments of salvation. He hath covered me with robes of righteousness. What kind of robes? What kind of garments? As a bridegroom decketh himself for ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels. That's the kind of covering that we have. One that's prepared for the wedding. For as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causes the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause the righteousness and praise to spring forth before all nations. Let's just pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your word. God, we're so thankful for a place to come and gather and to worship your name, Lord. And we just pray right now, Lord, that you would be the one that had preeminence, Lord. God, we haven't come to hear the words of a man. We haven't come to hear the thinking of a man. That's all pointless, Lord. It's all vanity. But we've come to hear from you, God. And we know that you've chosen a method to deliver your mind, deliver your word, and that's through the foolishness of preaching. So we all right now this morning submit ourselves to that method that you've laid out in your word. Lord, I submit myself to that as a vessel that you can use. I pray, God, that I could just lay my thoughts to the side, Lord, and that you would just use these lips of clay to speak eternal life to your children. We ask that you'd be with us in every part of the service. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. You can all be seated. Amen. This morning I want to preach on the rise of the queen. The rise of the queen as a subject. And I'm going to have to break this down into a couple parts. So the first part, I just chose a subtitle of Choosing a Bride. So the rise of a queen, we're going to start with choosing a bride. Now, Brother Branham said something in Christ is the Mystery of God Revealed, and I've read it here before, but I thought it'd be good to go over again. He said, God's great mystery of how it's a secret, he kept it a secret. Nobody knew nothing about it. Even the angels didn't understand it. See, he didn't reveal it. That's the reason under our seventh mystery, when the seventh seal was opened, there was silence. Jesus, when he was on the earth, they wanted to know when he would come. He said, it's not even him, the Son himself don't know when it's going to happen. See, God has this all to himself. It's a secret. And that's the reason there was silence in heaven for the space of half an hour, and seven thunders uttered their voices, and John was even forbidden to write it. See, the coming of the Lord. So he's talking about this great secret, and we've went through this here. The great secret was the coming of the Lord. It was the seventh seal, and it was in a mystery form, and that's what he's going to preach about here in Christ is the mystery of God revealed. But the next thing is what I want us to catch. That's the one thing he hasn't revealed yet of how he will come and when he will come. It's a good thing that he doesn't know. He has showed it or revealed it in every type that's in the Bible. Have we been seeing that? Amen. That's what I want to look at again because I want to go through the story of Esther this morning. He has showed or revealed it in every type that's in the Bible. Therefore, the entire Bible is the revelation of God's mystery in Christ. The entire Bible is an expression of one goal that God had, one purpose he wanted to achieve in the entire Bible, and all the acts of the believers in the Bible has been in type and expressing what God's great goal is, and now in this last day, he has revealed it and shows it. Now in these last days, he will reveal it, and that's not what the prophet said. Now in these last days, he has revealed it and shows it, and he's continuing to show it. Amen. So we know that when we read the Bible now, the prophet of God told us, we don't read the Bible like we read a newspaper. It's a love letter, right? And when you read a love letter from somebody you have an intimate knowledge about and somebody that you're in an intimate relationship with, right? Now, in that kind of love letter, I can pick up this love letter that somebody wrote to somebody else, all right? All right, say girl wrote to boy this love letter. So I pick up the love letter, and most of it's going to be nonsense to me, for it's going to turn my stomach for the first part. I'm not going to enjoy it, because nobody likes reading love letters that belong to somebody else. It's nauseating. But when it's your love letter, oh my goodness. We'll save it in a shoebox. We'll put it on a thing. We'll be 80 years old, and we'll pull it back out, and the perfume will still come off the love letter, right? Because why? It's your letter. It's addressed to you. So I can pick up somebody else's letter and read it, and most of it's not going to make any sense to me because I haven't experienced these things with this person. I don't know what they're referring to. I don't know what these little secret messages are or what the in-between-the-line reading is. Amen. But to the one who wrote it and to the one who's reading it, they get it. And this Bible is a love letter written to the bride of Jesus Christ. And a lot of people will read that and they'll either nauseate them or they won't have a clue what it's talking about. But the bride, it's for her. She knows what it is. And when she reads it, she still gets Twitter pated just the same as day one. Right? Amen. It gets more real and it gets more vivid and it becomes more alive the more we read this because we're reading it by revelation. And the revelation of the mystery is getting richer and richer and richer. Amen. So I want to take a look at Esther. Let's all of us turn together to the book of Esther. And I just want to pull a little bit out of Esther on this rise of a queen. We're all pretty familiar with this story. And so there's a lot of types and shadows in the book of Esther. It's amazing for all the time that people feel like there's a lot of people in the world conditioned today because we're in a world, especially in the Western Hemisphere, especially in Western society, that believes the old ways are wrong and the new ways are better and things from way back were archaic or medieval and that the Bible is part of that and some of the cause of that. And they believe that the Bible is hard on women, and they believe the Bible doesn't give equal rights and all this other stuff. And they don't realize the Bible talks about women all the time. You've got Esther, and you've got Ruth, and you've got all these stories in the Bible. They just don't understand how special the woman type is in Scripture. She's not oppressed. She's not pushed down. Amen. The woman type is actually beautiful when you read it in Scripture and understand it's always a type of the bride. And when you catch that vision, the Bible talks a lot about women. The Bible promotes women. The Bible puts women in the right place because it's a beautiful position. The problem is the modern thinking doesn't want a woman in that position. She wants a woman in a different position. And because the Bible doesn't speak that way, they think the Bible's wrong. But the Bible's not wrong. So let's go back here and look at the book of Esther. Esther chapter 1, verse 1. And I want you to pay close attention to the revelation of the seventh seal. Amen? All right. What was the revelation of the seventh seal? Three parts. They get preeminence in a man, they get preeminence in the bride, the church, and to restore the kingdom back, king and queen, back in Eden condition, right? That's the three parts of the great mystery, three parts of the seventh seal, amen? Three parts of the coming of the Lord, coming in the man, coming in the woman, man and woman coming together. Got it? We've got king, queen, king and queen. Oh, it's so simple. We'll walk all over it if we don't catch it and see it in the scriptures. So we want to take a look at the seventh seal here in the book of Esther, and I want you to pay close attention to the numbers. Amen. Because they tell us a story. Now it came to pass in the days of Ahasuerus, this is the Ahasuerus which reigned from India even unto Ethiopia over 127 provinces. That in those days, when the king Azarus sat on the throne of his kingdom, which was in Shushan the palace, in the third year of his reign, right? Not in the second year of a reign, something's going to transition, something that is telling the story of redemption. There's a story of redemption that's going to be told here, and the story of redemption doesn't happen in the second year. It doesn't happen in the fifth year. It happens in the third year. Brother Branham told us that in the church ages that this church went down into the dark ages, but through three stages was restored back. Jesus says, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll build it back. Amen. And so now the church temple was destroyed by Babylon through the dark ages, but there was a remnant came out and rebuilt the temple, and in three stages it came back. Amen. So in the third year of this king, of his reign, he made a feast unto all his princes and his servants, the power of Persia and Media, the nobles and the princes of the provinces being before him. When he showed the riches of his glorious kingdom in the honor of his excellent majesty, many days, even 84 days. That's 180 days. And when these days were expired, so I want to look at 180 days really quickly, just very quickly. The old Jewish calendar is 30 days to a month, 360 days in a year. So 180 days is exactly 6 months. So he did this for 6 months, but after 6 months, when 6 months were expired, now he's going to do something different. When is he going to do something different? In the seventh month. Hallelujah. When is the redemption finished in the feast of the Lord? In the seventh month. You have trumpets, you have atonement, you have tabernacles. The last part of redemption is in the seventh month. When is atonement? In the seventh month. How many church ages are there? Seven. It's completion. Amen. So after 180 days, he did this for 180 days. And when these days were expired, now we move into the seventh month. And in the seventh month, the king made a feast unto all the people that were present in Shushan the palace, both unto great and small, 7 days. My goodness. Brother Branham said, if you missed the numerology in the Bible, you've missed the Bible. You go back and read it again. This is all 3 and 7, 7th month and 7 days and third year. It's all the story of redemption all over again. Every story is a story of redemption. Amen. 7 days in the court of the garden of the king's palace. Let's jump over to verse 10. On the seventh day... Not on the sixth day, not on the fifth day, not on the tenth day, but on the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine, he commanded Mahuman, Biztha, Harbanah, Bigtha, Abigtha, Zether, and Carcass. I hate reading names out of the Old Testament, especially in front of a crowd, because somebody's going to be like, that wasn't right. I would have said that differently. But we can trade places anytime you want to read names for me. All right, so he reads off these names. The seven, he commanded these seven, the seven chamberlains that served in the presence of Ahasuerus the king. Now, there's a command going to seven chamberlains, and chamberlains are eunuchs. And eunuchs served in the presence of the king. They didn't serve out in the kingdom. These were the seven eunuchs that served in the presence of the king. Now, what are eunuchs? Eunuchs are men that cannot propagate themselves. They have no seed. All right? So they're only there to propagate the king's commandments, not their own. These are the servants of the king and their eunuchs. They have no wife of their own. They have no seed of their own. They have no children of their own. They're there to propagate the king's commandments. These are the seven church age messengers. The church age messengers weren't sent. They come from the presence of the Lord, but they were not sent. The seven spirits that are before the throne, right? Come out in each age. They were not sent out, amen, to marry the church. They were not sent out to propagate themselves. They were not sent out to give their own word. They were sent out to bring forth the decree of the king. Amen. Amen. So these are seven chamberlains before the king. To bring, what is their purpose? To bring Vashti the queen before the king with the crown royal, for to show the people and the princess her beauty, for she was fair to look upon. Amen. But the queen Vashti refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. Therefore was the king very wroth, and his anger burned in him. Now you notice, when it was time for the queen to be presented on the seventh day, it was time, the king sent out a decree by seven chamberlains. So it wasn't the king that went to the queen. It was the chamberlains that went to the queen with the king's message. And Vashti refused who? The chamberlains, which means she refused the king. To refuse the chamberlains is to refuse the king. To refuse the seven church age messengers is to refuse the king. Amen. He showed it in every type and shadow that's in the Bible. The same story over and over and over again. Once your eyes are opened, they're opened. You can't close them again. Hallelujah. What was Vashti doing this whole time? Go to verse 9. Go up to verse 9. Also, Vashti the queen made a feast for the women in the royal house which belonged to King Ahasuerus. Now here is this mighty queen, and this mighty queen has decided to take upon herself to have a feast while the king's having his feast, while things are going on for 6 months into the seventh month. She's doing her own little work over here on the side, and she's having a feast with the women or with the churches. Now she decides to have an ecumenical council. Now she brings in Vatican II. Amen. Are we paying attention? So now this queen is supposed to be the queen. Now she is having the feast with women. That's why denomination is homosexuality, because it's churches dominating churches, women dominating women. They have no seed, no propagation. Amen. You only get that from the king. Amen. That's why you can't be born again by connecting to the eunuch. You can't be born again by marrying the messenger, only by connecting to the king. Because the eunuch doesn't have seed, but the king does. Amen. So now Vashti's having her little banquet with the women. Now the king sends the seven chamberlains, the seven messengers, the seven church age messengers over, and she refuses. The king is not happy. But look at the response of the king. But the queen, in verse 12, refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. How does she refuse the king? By his chamberlains. How did the command of the king come? By his chamberlains. And when she refused to heed the call of the chamberlains, she refused the king. Therefore was the king very wroth, and his anger burned in him. Don't think that you're going to refuse him this day and not face judgment. Amen. It didn't work in this day in the book of Esther, and it's certainly not going to work in this day when God has sent back all seven spirits and seven thunders in the last day and revealed the whole thing in a mighty way. And basically, he sent all seven chamberlains in this day. The full message, the full revelation, all seven thundering out in consecutive order. And all seven have come to bid the queen to come, and she refused. And don't think that you're going to refuse today and expect anything different whatsoever, because grace is found in listening to the chamberlains. Grace is found in the commandment of the king, not in doing whatever soever we think we want to do. Now the word Vashti means beautiful. The actual interpretation of Vashti is beautiful. And I want you to turn with me to Revelations chapter 17. We're going to find Vashti in the scriptures. Revelation 17, starting at verse 3. So he carried me away in the spirit in the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. The woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. We know that this is the Catholic Church. In verse 5, it's called Mystery Babylon. And Mystery Babylon is the Catholic Church, who's a mother of harlots. She's a whore, and she's a mother of harlots, which are the Protestant systems. The denominational systems are whore and harlots. But look how beautiful she was. She's arrayed in purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand. She's not ugly. She's not scary looking. She doesn't look hideous and nasty like a witch. She's beautiful, so much so that John, he marveled. He looked upon her with great admiration. He was astonished. She was so beautiful to behold. But she was beautiful, but she was wrong. Vashti was beautiful, but Vashti was wrong. Let's go over to Revelations 18. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having a great power, and the earth was lighted with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, is become the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. That's the condition, according to the scripture, of the Catholic Church. That's what they are now. Fallen in the hold for every devil and unclean spirit. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornications, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. We've been watching that happen. We've been watching the kings drunk with her fornications. They got drunk at the United Nations. They got drunk at the White House. They got drunk in Congress when the Pope showed up, believing his lies and his deceit. And I heard another voice. Thank God for another voice. There's one that declares the condition of the church systems, but there's also another voice giving instructions on what to do about the conditions. And another voice, and I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her double according to her works, and the cup which she hath filled to her double. How much she has glorified herself. Who's being glorified? She is. Now, Vashti forgot who her husband was. Vashti forgot how she became a queen. because she became a queen by marrying the king. Not of her own merit, not of her own worth, and not, she didn't rise to queen all by herself. You can't be a queen without marrying the king. And she forgot how she got to her position. Amen. Now the church here in Revelation 18 has forgot who would ever make her special, who would make her the queen. Now she's glorified herself and lived deliciously. So much torment and sorrow give her, for she saith in her heart, I sit a queen and am no widow and shall see no sorrow. Amen. Do you think that the great churches of the systems and the great denominational system churches and the great Catholic Church, do you think they're going to see destruction in this age? Do you think they think they're going to miss the rapture and fall into tribulation? No. I sit as a queen. I am no widow, and I will see no sorrow. Next verse. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day. Death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire, for strong is the Lord God who judgeth her. Her destruction will come in one day when Russia drops a nuclear bomb on the Vatican, and her destruction will come in one day. The scripture will be fulfilled. Let's go back to Revelation 3. And look at the condition of the church. Verse 14, and unto the angel of the church of Laodicea write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. Same condition in the entire church age that we find in Mystery Babylon, because the whore has passed it to the harlots, and the harlots has passed it through the waters that she sits over, through the people, nations, and tongues. And now the people in this age, the people that are still stuck in Laodicea, the age that we're living in the natural life, the people in that age, they're still saying, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. He's not talking about a natural condition. He's talking about a spiritual condition. They're not saying I'm rich with money and all this. He's talking about the spiritual condition. They believe spiritually they're rich. They believe spiritually they're increased with goods. And spiritually they have need of nothing. And he's going to point out the spiritual condition. Knowest thou not thou art wretched and miserable, poor and blind and naked? I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. Amen. Let's go back to Esther. Queen Vashti means beautiful. Amen. She had worldly beauty. She had no character. Verse 19, still in chapter 1 of Esther. If it please the king, let there go a royal commandment from him, and let it be written among the laws of the Persians and the Medes. So now there's a problem. What are we going to do about this Vashti? And I want to back up here for just a minute to verse 16, because I want to show something that's amazing. In verse 16 it says, and Mumakan answered before the king and the princes, Vashti the queen hath not done wrong to the king only, but also to all the princes and to all the people that are in all the provinces of King Ahasuerus. Now, it's amazing. There are 7 princes that sit before the king and help him rule. And in 7 princes, the last prince or the 7th prince is this Mumakan. And Mumakan is the one who catches the revelation of the significance of this event. It's interesting. It wasn't the 3rd one mentioned. It wasn't the 4th. It wasn't the 5th. It was the 7th prince. Consistent. Do we see the consistency in the scripture? The 7th one, he's the one who catches the significance of this event, and he's the one who comes up with the solution. Right. And here's part of the solution in verse 19. If it please the king, let there go out a royal commandment from him, and let it be written among the laws of the Persians and the Medes, that it be not altered, that Vashti come no more before the king Ahasuerus, and let the king give her royal estate unto another that is better than she. How are you going to get better than Vashti? Vashti's beautiful. Vashti's the most beautiful. Vashti's got it all. How are you going to be better than Vashti? There was one place that Vashti was decrepit, and that was in character. She may have had wealth. She may have had a good bloodline. She may have had beauty that nobody could match, but she had no character, because character would have given her the heart to obey the command of the king. Because that's the true test of character. Go to chapter 2, verse 2. Then said the king's servant that ministered unto him, let there be fair young virgins sought for the king, and let the king appoint officers in all the provinces of his kingdom, that they may gather together all the fair young virgins unto Shushan the palace, to the house of the women, unto the custody of Haggai, the king's chamberlain, keeper of the women, and let their things be for purification be given them. And let the maiden which pleaseth the king be queen instead of Vashti. And the thing pleased the king, and he did so. Now, this is a great idea. He's got a wonderful idea. Let's gather fair young virgins from all over, and let's put them in the house of the women with Haggai. Haggai's another eunuch that is the servant of the king, another one that has no seed. Now he's the keeper of the women. Of who? The fair young virgins. What's his job? Prepare them to meet the king. Who do you think this is? Malachi 4, you got it, brother. Revelations 10:7. This is Haggai, the chamberlain, the eunuch that is in the service of the king, keeper of the house of women. And what's he doing? What's his ministry? He's preparing them to meet the king. Why? Because somebody's going to get married in the seventh month. Vashti's going to be refused in the seventh month because she refused the king, and somebody's going to get married in the seventh month. One of these fair young virgins is going to get married, but they got to go through Haggai, the keeper of the women, first. Nobody just walks into the presence of the king unprepared. You've got justification, the calling of the virgins. You've got sanctification, the house of purification with Haggai, and then you've got the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the night with the king. Amen. It's all in Esther. And it's been there for how many thousands of years? But it's been laying there as a love letter so that in the last days, a little bride can pick it up and say, that's me. I'm looking in the mirror. That's me, mama. That's me. I'm Esther. I'm not Vashti. I know I'm not Vashti because I won't refuse the king. Amen. How did they refuse the king? Refuse the chamberlains. Refuse the chamberlains. You refuse the king. So now we got to find one that pleaseth the king. Now the king is not this time looking for beauty. He had beauty. Vashti wasn't put away because she wasn't beautiful enough. Vashti wasn't put away because she wasn't perfect in every natural sense of the word perfect. Vashti wasn't put away because her bloodline wasn't good enough. Vashti was not put away because she didn't have the right mannerisms to be queen, because she didn't have the right mode of conduct or the right kind of speech and language. She had everything it took to be a good queen. She was put away for one reason and one reason only. Amen? And these church systems of this age have been put away for one reason and one reason only, is because they refused the king. Amen. So he's not looking for another one with a royal bloodline. Amen. He's not looking for another one that knows how to say all the right words, knows how to conduct themselves in royal court, knows how to put on the royal apparel, and the one that's more beautiful than all the others. That's not what the king wants. What he's looking for now is somebody that will not refuse him. Oh, this is good. This is good. This is the king's choosing of a bride. Amen. I love it so much. Brother Branham says in The Choosing of a Bride, "Now when you see a church that's in the world, acts like the world, anticipating in the world, partaking of the world, counting God's commandments as if he never had wrote them, you don't have to look very far to find that. As if he had never wrote them, then you can just imagine Christ ain't going to take a bride like that. Could you imagine taking the modern church today for a bride? Not my Lord. I could hardly see that. No, remember, now a man and his wife are one." What's Brother Branham teaching in Choosing of a Bride? He comes to Choosing of a Bride, and what he's showing is that a man will select a wife that will reflect his own character. Think about that. Now, he's typing in the natural, but he's trying to type the natural to the spiritual. He's trying to show Christ is not looking for a bride, just any old bride. He's not looking for the most beautiful of the church or the biggest number of people or those that can say it all right, that can pronounce all the words and have the Bible memorized. He's not looking for that. He's looking for a bride that reflects his very own character. Brother Bram said, if you go and you take just any old thing off the street and a man would just choose a woman that would live any old kind of unclean life and marry her, it shows what's inside of him. He's reflecting his own character by his choice for a wife. Now, if that's true in the natural and it's true in the spiritual, God cannot choose just any old thing and join himself to it because she wants to join to him. No, no, no. Because he's got his character to uphold. He's not going to join himself to anything that will not reflect his own character. That's why Vashti had to be put away, because she refused the king, and he's going to find one that won't refuse him. The book of Acts, speaking out the choosing of David for king. Acts 13:21. "And afterward they desired a king, and God gave unto them Saul the son of Kish, a man of the tribe of Benjamin, by the space of 40 years. And when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David to be their king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart." What did David do? Reflected the king's character. A man after mine own heart, a man that reflects my character. He said, I shall choose them a king of my choosing. Right? So Samuel went with the anointing oil to help choose the king, so he went to the house of Jesse. And Eliab, the firstborn, walks in, and he's everything a king should be. Everything a king should be. Head and shoulders, broad shoulders. He's a fighting man, big full beard. He's ready to go. The one they can respect, the one that the armies can follow behind. Samuel goes to put the oil over his head, and the Lord says, stop, I've refused him. Man sees on the outward, but God sees the heart. So if God's looking in the heart, what's he looking for? He's looking for what David had. Not what Eliab had, not what Saul had. He's looking for what David had. In Acts, he says, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after mine own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. That's what he's looking for. That's the character that he wants. Amen. He's not looking for beauty. He's not looking for broad shoulders. He's not looking for somebody that can command the respect of men. He's looking for somebody that will respect him and his word and his commandments. That's where Saul failed, but that's where David was successful. So what's the king looking for? He's looking for character. Brother Ben, finishing this quote from Choosing of a Bride. And then, how about God joining himself to something like that, a regular denominational prostitute? You think he would do it? Having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof? He would never do it. Amen. There's a scripture in the Old Testament. I didn't pull it up, so you'll have to find it later. It says, in that day, seven women shall grab a hold of one man and say, we will eat our own bread and we will basically take care of ourselves. Only give us of thy name. Right. What did they want? They wanted the benefits of the name. They wanted the benefits of the relationship, but they really wanted to do it their own way. Amen? And there's been seven church ages, so seven women have all treated the Lord the same way. They've grabbed a hold of him and said, we'll eat our own bread, we'll do our own thing, only give us of your name. Right. And they've taken the name and they've attached it to the church of Jesus Christ, the church of Christ, church of this, church of that. Brother Branham said those are blasphemous names. Why are they blasphemous names? Because the church doctrine is blaspheming the Word of God, blaspheming the Holy Ghost. And so they've taken his name, amen, but they've not married to him. They've not submitted to him. They've not given up their life. They still want to eat their own bread and go their own way. If you want to understand denominationalism, that's it right there. Give us your name, but we'll do our own thing. Amen. That's what Vashti thought she could do. It didn't work. So she was put away. He would never do that back in choosing of a bride. She must have his character in her. She must have his character in her. The real, true, born-again church must have the character that was in Christ, because the husband and the wife are one. And if Jesus did only that which pleased God, kept his word and manifest his word, his bride will have to be of the same kind of character. She could not by no means be a denomination. Hallelujah. You know what? I love that we have a voice in this day that will stand against every other voice that's speaking. Amen. Brother Bram said in end time evangelism, God's looking for character, not membership. Character. Eliezer, when he went to get the bride for Isaac, he sweated it out until he found character. That's the end time message. He and the bride, God's looking for character. And then after Eliezer found the character, then the next thing was getting her ready to go. That's the same now, brother, the same now. Brother Branham's ministry was the ministry of Eliezer. What was his ministry? To find and bring a bride to Isaac. Amen? Then he says in God hiding himself in simplicity. First message when he preached the series on the seals. He's talking about the dedication of the tabernacle. He says, may it be a consecrated place to our Lord, a consecrated people, for no matter how beautiful the structure is, that we certainly do appreciate, the beauty of the church is the character of the people. I trust it'll always be a house of God's beauty. A house of God of beauty. Amen. Let's pick up our story back in Esther again. We're in chapter 2. Let's go to verse 5 because Esther's about to step on the scene. Now, Esther doesn't step on the scene until after Vashti's refused. Now in Shushan the palace, there was a certain Jew whose name was Mordecai, the son of Jar, the son of Shimei, the son of Kish, a Benjamite. Another thing that I find interesting in the story of redemption that's in Esther here is somehow Esther's rise to the throne has something to do with the tribe of Benjamin. That's amazing. Because Brother Branham calls the 144,000 that are redeemed out of the nation of Israel by the two prophets in Revelation 11, he calls them the tribe of Benjamin. The 144,000, the little Benjaminites. Amen. So now, Mordecai could have been from any tribe, right? There's 12 to pick from. He happened to be a Benjamite because the queen and the 144,000, their destinies are interlocked. Amen. Let's verse down to 7. And he brought up Hadassah, that is Esther, his uncle's daughter, for she had neither father nor mother, and the maid was fair and beautiful, whom Mordecai, when her father and mother were dead, took for his own daughter. So now we find out where Esther comes from. Now Esther's going to be selected when all these fair virgins are selected, and she's going to go into the house. Now let's look at this story in verse 13. Then thus came every maid unto the king. Whatsoever she desired was given to her to go with her out of the house of the women into the king's house. In the evening she went, and on the morrow she returned in the second house of the women to the custody of Sheshgaz, the king's chamberlain, which kept the concubines. She came in unto the king no more, except the king delighted in her, and that she were called by name. Now, I want to look at this in verse 13. She goes to the house of women, which is oversaw by Haggai, the king's chamberlain. And the king is there, or the chamberlain is there, to make sure that the women go through the purification process. That's his job, to make sure they have everything they need for purification. That means that they have all the spices and all the oils and all the baths and everything they need. And he took Esther, and Esther found favor in his eyes, and he set her in a good part of the house with seven maids of her own. She had seven maids. So he puts her there, and he's giving all the fair young virgins, they're all getting what they need to prepare to go in and meet the king. Because they can't just walk in and meet the king. They can't just come off the street and meet the king. There has to be a preparation so that they can become one with the king. So they're going through a sanctification process, and they're going through a purification process that they go into the king. Amen. But it says, whatsoever, when it came time for her to go into the king, now she's had whatever Haggai has ordered for her for the purification process, the ointments and the oils and the perfumes and the baths and the whatever, the hair care products, whatever, they got the best of the best, I'm sure. I mean, it was a salon, and this salon lasted 12 months. How many manicures can you get in 12 months? All right? So the purification process was 12 months long, and they had everything that they ever needed before they went to the king. But there was also this stipulation. Whatever she desired was given her to go with her out of the house of the women into the king's house. So her free moral agency was never taken away. She could take with her to go stand before the king and to meet the king, to see whether the king is pleased with her or not. She could take anything she wanted with her. God has never taken away our free moral agency. But our free moral agency is a test. Always has been and always will be. What is it that you want to take with you to the presence of the king? What is it that you want to hold on to? Is it a relationship? Is it a friend? Is it a husband? Is it a wife? Is it a son? Is it a daughter? What are you trying to drag with you into the presence of the king? Because you can take whatsoever you want. Amen. Amen. Now, verse 14, in the evening she went, and on the morrow she returned. So she came out of the house of Haggai, the house of the women for preparation. She went to meet the king, and then the next day she went to the house of concubines. Except, that was the process. Here, to here, to here. Except, she came into the kingdom more, except the king delight in her, and that she were called by name. Now, when it comes to the choosing of a bride, this is so good, I can't hardly stand it. When it comes to the choosing of a bride, it's Haggai's job to find the virgins, to get them in the house, and to make sure that they're ready for their encounter with the king. But these virgins are never, they've never lost their free moral agency. They can go stand there in any condition they want. They can take anything they want with them. And then it's not Haggai who chooses. It's the king himself who chooses the bride by calling her name. Oh, Haggai can't pick the bride. Haggai, he may have his favorites. He may have his list of top 10. He may know who the top two contenders are in his mind, but Haggai can't choose the bride. Only the king can choose the one that pleases him. And if he has chosen her, she'll know because she will be called by name. Oh, it gets so exciting. I used to read the book of Esther, had no idea what it was about. Just a neat little love story, right? That's so neat. That little common girl, and all of a sudden she's a queen. That is so neat. And now, with a greater revelation, to go back and read Esther, and I'm looking in the mirror, and I'm saying, that's me. That's me. I've been in the house of purification. I've been chosen. Many are called, but few are chosen. I've been called to the house of virgins. I've been justified. I've been sanctified through the purification process. But I went to my encounter with the king. Brother Branham talked about a fourth step. The fourth step, you know, Pentecost got a baptism of the Holy Ghost. Pentecost got an encounter with the king, but they weren't allowed to marry him. Something beyond a night with the king is going to take place. Somebody's going to get their name called, and somebody's going to be the queen. Hallelujah. Let's just look at this. Calling a name for a minute. Before we get there, let's look at calling a name. Questions and answers on the seals. They had a question about who will be saved, and he says, nothing will be saved, only those whose names were written and put on the Lamb's Book of Life before the foundation of the world, Jew or Gentile. See, that's all. The book holds the mystery, and the book is unfolding it now. He's in questions and answers on the seals between the sixth and seventh seal. The book is only unfolding it now. Not each one's name, but what the mystery of the book is while it's calling those names. What's calling the names? The unfolding of the mystery of the book. You understand that now? The book doesn't say, now leave veils to be saved in the time of this church age, or Orman Neville, or whoever. No, it don't say that. It just shows the mystery, unfolds the mystery of what the thing is. But we ourselves, by faith, believe it. What's he talking about? The calling of your name. How's he calling your name? By revealing the mystery in the seven seal book. And the mystery unfolds the names that are in the book. And it's not that you look down and you not see Lee Vale will come out. It's not that kind of reading of a name. But the unveiling of the book is calling your name. Yes. Who's calling your name? Was it Haggai? No, it was the king. How many people heard about the unfolding of the book? How many people heard about what was taking place and they didn't hear their name? But there's a few people on the earth, when they heard the unfolding of the book, they heard more than there's a white horse rider. They've heard more than a red horse rider. They heard more than souls under the altar. They heard their name. They said, I'm there. That's me. That's my redemption. That's my title deed. What do we find? We found our position in the book. Not because I looked over and read, and not because Brother Branham said Chad Lamb will be here. He'll come in 1977. No, when it was my time in the presence of the king, I heard my name. Why? How? By the unfolding of the mysteries. Hallelujah. Let's go back to our scripture. Verse 15. Now when the turn of Esther, the daughter of Abihail, the uncle of Mordecai, who had taken her for daughter, was to come to go into the king. Now listen, she had free moral agency. Every other woman could take whatsoever she desired through the presence of the king. But listen to what Esther chose to take. She required nothing but what Haggai, the king's chamberlain, the keeper of the women, appointed. Not her own idea, not her own thought, not another relationship, not a denominational way of thinking, not somebody else's idea on it. She, when she went to her encounter with the king, she took only what Haggai, the chamberlain, the keeper of the women, the prophet of the seventh age, the seventh messenger, only what he appointed. Nobody else goes into his presence like that except for the bride. Esther's the only one. Everybody else has their own little idea of what God likes or what will please the king or God just loves me or I'm so sweet and I'm so special he would never refuse me. He had that in Vashti. He ain't looking for it again. That's why they were given permission to take anything they wanted with them to the presence of the king. Oh, he'll like this little lipstick, and he'll like this eyeshadow. He'll like these heels. He'll like this little dress. He'll like this. And Haggai, you know what? Not one of these virgins have ever been in the presence of the king before. But guess who's been there? Guess who knows what the king likes? Guess who's the one who's actually been in his presence? Guess who the one that the king gives commandments lip to ear to? It's the Haggai. It's not the virgins. They've never one time, ever one time had the Lord speak to them directly, but Haggai has. And so now these foolish virgins think that they know what's going to please the king, and the Haggai's an old crank, and he don't know, but I'm so special, he'll choose me. The king had that in Vashti, and the king doesn't want it no more, and he doesn't want it today. What he wants is an Esther who will step up, a fair young virgin who's went through a purification process in the house that Haggai is watching over, that'll step up and require nothing but what came from that prophet, because he's been there, and he knows what he's talking about. That's why every denominational system has failed, because she goes in her own thinking, mix her idea with the Word of God, and come out with something polluted and produced another Vashti. Well, the king went through that once. He ain't going through it again. Amen? We know that this chamberlain knew what he was talking about. We know this chamberlain's been behind the veil. He's been to the inner chamber. He's seen the high court of the Lord. He's seen the book in his hand. He's seen it open. He knows exactly what he's talking about. So Esther's sitting there. I don't know. I'll just take what he said and not add my own interpretation to it. I'll just take what he said when it's my time to encounter the king. Hallelujah. You see the fallacy of leaving this message behind? It's a virgin trying to put lipstick and rouge on herself to please the king. She has no idea what the king likes. But Haggai got the commandment lip to ear, and he knows what the king likes. That's why in the natural type, it's so foolish that we still have to play games with how long is long hair and how much makeup and how short is my skirt. Just listen to what Haggai said. He's been there. He knows what he's talking about. But we've got our own ideas about this. Oh, well, this is okay and that's okay. How do you know it's okay? You don't know it's okay. Listen to the one who knows. Amen. We would rather walk a line to please man than run away from the line to please God. And that's exactly what all that is just trying to get some approval from our fellow sister or brother. Who cares about your sister and brother? Haggai told you how to get approval from God. She required nothing but what Haggai, the king's chamberlain, the keeper of the woman, appointed. And Esther obtained favor in the sight of all them that looked upon her. So Esther was taken into King Ahasuerus, into the house royal. Guess when? In the 10th month, which is the month Tebeth, in the 7th year of his reign. You mean she went in 10-7? When did she go in? In 10-7? You mean like Revelations 10-7? When the mystery of God is revealed, that's when she goes into the king? Absolutely. Because that's when the mighty angel comes down to what? Join himself with the bride. So she went in 10-7. When was atonement? In the 10th day of the 7th month. Leviticus 23. When it speaks of the day of atonement, it flips them and says, not in the 7th month and on the 10th day. No. It says, in the 10th day, on the 10th day of the 7th month. Because redemption and atonement is completed in 10-7. Amen. It's come to fullness in 10-7. And Esther goes into the king in 10-7. Oh, do you read the love letter now? Are you reading it? Is this your love letter? Are you reading between the lines? Who cares about a day and a month? I'm here in 10-7. Hallelujah. I found my place in 10-7. I heard my name called in 10-7.
What about you? I had my encounter with the king in 10:7. What about you? Amen. Praise God. She went into the house royal in the 10th month, which is the month Tebeth, in the 7th year of his reign. And the king loved Esther above all the women. And she obtained grace and favor in his sight more than all the virgins, so that he set the royal crown upon her head and made her queen instead of Vashti. Oh, we got a queen in this day. Think she's a queen. Says, I sit a queen and have need of nothing, and no sorrow will come to me. She doesn't know she's already been dethroned. And he's already selected another queen, and he's about to reveal it to the whole world. Amen. Praise God. Now Vashti went in. She required only those things that Haggai appointed. That was her perfume. That was how she did her hair. That was the clothing she wore, the kind of shoes she had. All of that was determined by Haggai. Brother Branham says, in the present stage of my ministry, he says, I hope he will crown my ministry of this, of letting me take the clothes of the word and dress his bride. Brother Branham's saying, in 1962, before the seals, and he's here in September, and he's going to get the vision for Christ is the mystery in December, just a couple months later, and that's going to bring out the sequence of events that's going to bring the opening of the word, the opening of the seals. He says, I hope he will crown my ministry of this, of letting me take the clothes of the word and dress his bride in the cloth of the word for his righteousness. What else are you going to put on? What else are you going to put on? You're going to have a Baptist sleeve and a Pentecostal skirt and a Catholic top? It's not going to work. But this Haggai, his crowning of his ministry was to give clothes, the right kind of garment. Spiritual now. He's talking spiritual. The right kind of clothing so that we can be clothed in the wedding garment to meet the king. Oh, there is no other way outside this message. None. I'll say it every day. I'll say it every time I get in the pulpit. There is no other way to meet and be accepted by the king outside of this message, because it was the preparation work. It was the work in the house of the women. It was Haggai who knew, who had been in the inner chamber, who knew how to prepare Esther for her meeting with him. And it's all about character. Why could Esther and not all the other women just take what Haggai said? How come all the other women had to take a little extra or do a little something else? They had no character. They might have all been beautiful, but it doesn't matter. The king already had beauty. Now he's not interested in beauty. Now he's interested in character. That's why he's not looking for a big church or a denomination or this, that, or the other. There's no organization. There's no big system. There's no great programs. We ain't got it, and we don't want it. We only want that which Haggai has appointed. Amen. In the choosing of a bride, Brother Branham's talking about, he makes a funny story about a cow. How many remembers? Don't get all offended, sisters. He's just trying to make a type. He says he was with this rancher, and this rancher would look to buy beef cows to raise steers. And he said he'd look at her, he'd look her up and down, and then he'd turn her head and look her in the eye. He said sometimes he'd just shake his head and walk away. He asked him one day, he said, Jeff, why you look that cow in the face? She looks all right to me. He says, she may be all right. She may be beef clumb to the hoof. But if she's got that wild stare in her eye, what was the rancher looking for? Character. Said, she'll never be a mammy. She'll never sit still. She'll run the fences, all this other stuff. And Brother Ram says, I think I learned a lesson about women. He said, you better too, brother. Because if you get one with that wild stare in her eye, she'll never be a mom. She'll want to go work in some man's office. She'll want to go do this, that, and be the head of the house and go do her own thing. Amen. That won't make a Christian home. Amen. So he said, you better watch. And Brother Branham is typing this to Christ and the bride. He's taking the naturals about choosing a man would choose his bride to reflect his own care, and he's typing that right in to Christ and the bride, how Christ is choosing a bride. And he's chosen her for predestination. All right. But in his predestinated thought, he's always got this testing time. Right? Always has this testing time where you've got to be tested. All right? And Esther went through her testing time with Haggai and her approach into the king. But he's got to have this testing time where if she meets the conditions, then he's going to do something special. He's going to call her name. When? After she's come into his presence and after she's met the condition. Now, just as soon as the king makes his choice, the moment the king makes his choice, every other virgin is a concubine.
Amen. Right.
He's only got one bride.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how good the church is. It doesn't matter how good the system is. Doesn't matter how much they got right. Just as soon as he comes to choose a bride, every other thing becomes a concubine. Amen. Because only one is going to bear forth seed. Brother Branham, I want to back up just a minute, and I want to talk about what we talked about here. I think it was last Sunday. And last Sunday when we talked about redemption and the work of the high priest. I believe it was last Sunday. And how the high priest would go on behind the mercy seat and do 7 sprinklings of blood. And when that was done, it was for the ignorance of the people. And then he would come around and there'd be 7 sprinklings before the throne. And we showed how Jesus had been doing that work down through 7 church ages. Do we remember that? Are we all on the same page? And how when he comes forth now on that Day of Atonement, he takes the simple garment, because he's got royal robes. The high priests have royal robes, right? And the high priest has a glorification. He's got all the special things that he wears. But on the Day of Atonement, he takes all the glorification off and puts on a simple linen garment for atonement. And that was when Christ came in the form of the Lamb, which was Jesus, the flesh man. And then he does the work of the high priest. And when he's done with the work of the high priest, when atonement's finished, he takes off the simple linen garment and he leaves it in the sanctuary. And then he comes out to the people. And when he emerges from there, they know that their sins are gone, that atonement's been successful.
Amen.
And all the sins of the nation are gone. It's been no different in our day.
Amen.
All right. So we talked about the lion and the lamb. You've got to separate the lion and the lamb because these are both attributes of Christ. Right? He says, behold, the lion of the tribe of Judah, he has prevailed. Amen. He's worthy to take the book and loose the seals thereof. And he said, when I turned and looked, I saw a lamb as it had been slain. The lion prevailed, but the lamb standing there. Because the lion and the lamb are the same person. It's Christ. The lamb is the flesh body of Jesus. Christ is the Christ, the Logos of God from the beginning. We got that. So now, on this Day of Atonement, or this great work in atonement in heaven is complete after 7 church ages, now he takes off the simple linen garment and the Lamb, Jesus, stays in the sanctuary. We got that? All right. So if the Lamb stays there, who was it that came out? The Lion of the tribe of Judah. The King. What's he doing? Why did the king come? And what's the purpose of the king coming? In the breach between the 7 churches and the 7 seals. He said he's done his kinsman work. You know what the kinsman work was? To testify before the elders. You remember Boaz kicked off a shoe and so forth. He's done all this now. He's talking about the breach. He's talking about Revelation chapter 5 when the Lamb comes and opens the seals. He said he's been doing the kinsman work. Now, he types it with Boaz doing the work of kinsman redeemer. Now, when did Boaz marry Ruth? Was it before the work of redemption, during the work of redemption, or after the work of redemption? after he was finished, after Boaz had fully redeemed, then Boaz, after he paid the price, how he made the contract, how he'd done everything he had to do, then he comes and he takes Ruth and he marries Ruth. Right? Here, Brother Branham's saying he's done all this now. Now he comes to take his bride. He comes now as a king. Who? The Lion of the Tribe of Judah. Revelation 10, the mighty angel came down, and when he thundered, he roared as when a lion roareth. Why did he roar? Because he's not coming as the lamb. That's the corporal body meeting in the air at the rapture. He's coming now as the lion, the king. He comes now as a king. He's looking for his queen. In this book is the whole secret of it wrapped around seven seals. Seven seals waiting for him to come. And the fifth seal. Actually, in the Christ is the mystery of God revealed. Webster says, revelate, to reveal, Webster says, is to make known. Make known, and especially Webster says in divine truth. The revelation means the revelation, it's Christ's way of making himself known to his church. How do you hear your name called? By the unfolding of the mysteries. The mysteries are what? Christ. Then he says, let me get this right. Then he says, now somebody, first seal, now someday he rises from the Father's throne and he goes to take his own throne. Now he comes forth to call his subjects. Now, how's he going to claim them? Now remember, he's done the work of kinsman redeemer. The lamb remains in the sanctuary. The lion of the tribe of Judah, the theophany of God, the fullness of the Holy Ghost comes down. The lion of the tribe of Judah comes down. He's a king looking for his queen. He's calling, he's coming to claim his redeemed subjects. First seal, he says, he comes forth to call his subjects. How's he going to claim them? He's already got a book of redemption in his hand. When that mighty angel in Revelation 10 comes down, what's in his hand? An open book. Now the king comes and he's looking for a queen. He's coming for his redeemed subjects. How's he going to call them? He's already got the book of redemption in his hand. How's he going to find the queen? He's already got the book of redemption in his hand. Do you get it yet? He goes over to the goats. They just look at the book. They sniff it. They might lick it. Then they turn away and go some other direction. He comes over here to the cattle. And he's approaching to the cattle. Mighty angel, Christ, open book in his hand. Comes to the cattle. They look at it. He moves around to where their head is. You know, Christ doesn't force feed anybody. The Holy Spirit's a gentleman. He'll just present the truth. Here's a book now. They turn and go another direction. He takes it to the camels. Amen. He takes it to all the beasts of the field. But then one day, he steps in front of a sheep. And the sheep rips it out of his hands and gobbles it up. What's he doing? He's a king looking for his queen. Amen. The prophet, the angel that was with John, tells John, when he sees the mighty angel with the book in his hand, John sees it. John sees the mighty angel comes down, hears the roar of the like a lion roar, and he's looking down, and he sees him with his hand, but John's not quite sure what to do. But this messenger that's with John says, go and take the book that's in the hand of the angel. So John goes to take the book, and what does John say? Oh, please, angel, sir, if you could be so kind, could I please maybe touch the book, sniff the book, flip a few pages of the book? No, John has already caught a revelation, because the prophet of God says John caught a revelation that his name was in the book. Why was John shouting when the Lamb took the book? Why was he shouting a fit that everybody in heaven, everybody on earth, and everybody under the earth heard him praising and worshiping God? Is because he realized that's his redemption. He realized his name was in the book. Now, John couldn't have looked over and actually read it. Brother Bram said he must have read his name. He couldn't, because it was still sealed in his hand. It doesn't come sealed till the sixth, unsealed till the sixth chapter. But he looks at it, and something in John, he realizes, my name's in that book. That's my redemption. I'm part of that book. And he already caught a revelation of where he belonged.
Right.
Mighty angel comes down holding the book. The voice tells him, go take the book. And he doesn't walk up and beg for it. Why doesn't he beg for it? Because he's in it. If he's in it, it's his. He goes up and he says, give me that book. Oh, give me that book. Caleb, he saw a mountain he wanted. He went out and spied the land and he found a good place. And you know, the best pieces of ground are already taken. Always already taken. How many times you drive by a piece of ground? Oh, I love that piece of ground. Well, it's sold. Of course, it's sold. It's a good piece of ground.
Right.
Caleb sees a piece of ground, and he really likes it, only it's got giants on it. It's got the sons of Anakin on it. All right? He goes back, and these other 10 worthless spies with no vision, they say, we can't take the land. We can't do it. And only him and Joshua say, we're more than able because of the word. What's he standing on? He's not looking down at his muscles, right? He's not looking at the length of his sword. He says, it's been promised. He already told us. We're more than able to take it. It has nothing to do with Caleb. It has nothing to do with Joshua. It has everything to do with God. That's what the world has forgotten. He's looking for a queen that pleaseth him. We have totally lost our mind. Because the world is looking for a God that pleaseth them. A God of my own choosing, a God of my own desire, a God that his affections match my affections and his desires match my desires. So now we've got a queen, a woman trying to go grab a man and say, give me your name. But that's not how the queen's coming into power. That's not the rise of the queen. The rise of the queen is going to be the one that pleaseth him. Didn't say anything about what pleased Esther. Did you ever notice that? It never says one thing, not one time does it talk about in her choosing, in her preparation, in her going to meet the king. You know, it never one time says what Esther wants. Because what's more important, what Esther wants or what the king wants? But we flipped our doctrine in this age where it's not about the king anymore. Now it's about me. Surely he'll accept little old me. And trample over his word, you're wrong. He won't choose you. He won't select you. He won't unite to you. He won't put a seed in you. Why? Because you have to please him, not him please you. You don't choose him. He chooses you. Show me anywhere in the scriptures as anything different than that. So Caleb was spying out the land. These worthless spies, they ruined it for him. And so now he's got to wait 40 years. More years. But Moses tells him, you can have that land. That great mountain that you saw, amen, where the cities were and all the fruits and the vegetables and the land, it's yours. So when then they come into the land, Caleb goes up to Joshua, which is a type of the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost positionally places the people in the land. We're positionally placed in the Word, and it's the Holy Ghost who tells us our position in the Word. So he goes to the Holy Ghost, and Caleb, now remember, Caleb is a Gentile. His name is Dog. He's a Gentile, but he's a proselyte Jew after several generations. He's been grafted in to the tribe of Judah. Grafted into the tribe of Judah. You know what we happen to be? Gentiles, that were called dogs by the Jews, who have been grafted in by marriage to which tribe?
Judah.
Because Jesus sprang from Judah, we've been united to Christ, so by marriage we've been grafted into Judah. What's this story about Caleb? Is it about Caleb? No, it's about you. It's about me. It's a story of redemption all over again. The Gentile grafted into Judah. The dog. Oh, I don't care what you call me. Call me a blasphemer. Call me a heretic. Tell me I'm off on the word. But I know what's been promised to me in that land. The rest of the spies could have looked, well, Caleb, you're not even a real Jew. Caleb didn't care. Caleb caught the revelation. The rest of them failed. So Caleb goes to Joshua, the Holy Ghost, and he doesn't say, please, sir, may I? He doesn't say, if it be okay, if it would be according to your will and according to your kindness and not so bad and maybe a possibility that I could have what I want. No. He saw it already promised by a prophet. Moses had already told him it was his. So he knew it didn't belong to Joshua. It didn't belong to any other tribe. It didn't belong to any other church. It belonged to him. Him. It was his promise in the word. It was his promise that was given to him by a prophet. And he went up to Joshua and he says, give me my mountain. He's got poor etiquette. His manners are atrocious. He never said please, and I don't remember hearing him say thank you. Because it was his. He knew it was his. He was already revealed to him it was his. He was only claiming what was already his. And so now the mighty angel comes with the book of redemption. John already knows it's his. So he comes to the angel and he says, give me that book. Now the angel says, take it and eat it all up. Eat it all up. And in thy belly, it'll be bitter. But in my mouth, it'll be sweet as honey. Now, what would have happened if John would have taken the book and been a little bit nervous about the bitter part and said, I'm just going to take a little sample and I'm going to wait 24 hours and see what happens? Why do people come in the message and bail right back out? Why do people hang around for a little bit and jump ship? They're just, I just want to see what happens. I want to see how bad it gets. I want to see how bitter my belly really is. Oh, that is bitter. Persecution and rejection and called names and family members think you've went off the deep end and all kinds of other stuff. Amen? And because it's bitter in the belly, we jump ship. But guess what? It was too late for John to jump ship because before the bitterness hit his belly, he had already ate it all up. Amen. And the commandment isn't to nibble on this word. The commandment isn't just to try it for a little while, just to taste and see. The commandment is to eat it all up. The hard stuff. The stuff you don't understand, the things that look like contradictions, the things that baffle your mind, eat it all up. And guess what? In your belly, it'll be bitter. But that's okay. Because Paul told Timothy, don't drink water only, but why don't you take a little wine for your stomach's sake? Brother Bam taught us that wine is the stimulation of revelation. You want a cure for the bitterness in your belly? You get a good heaping dose of stimulation of revelation. You let God open your eyes to what this word is and your position in this word. And it doesn't matter about the bitterness anymore because now I've got a wine. I've got a revelation of what this is that makes me so happy. Brother Branham says, you ever see a drunk man? He's happy. He can fall in the ditch. He can be soaking wet. He can be cut and bruised. People could be making fun of him, but he's still singing. Because he caught the revelation. He got the stimulation of the wine. And our stimulation of the wine, we can be cut and bruised and rejected and cast stones at and called all kinds of names. It doesn't matter, because if I'm drinking of the wine of revelation, I'm happy and I'm still singing as I go along. Oh, they might be chucking rocks at me, and I'm so drunk on the Word of God, so stimulated by the revelation of who I am in Christ, that I can just sing. Hallelujah, I can sing. Chuck a rock at me, whizzes by my ear, call me a heretic, say I don't even know nothing about the Bible, and I say, oh, happy day. Oh, happy day. Hallelujah. There's a cure for the bitterness in your belly. And it's the stimulation of revelation that comes from the Father. Amen. He's come with an open book. What's he doing? He's the king looking for a queen. Are you the queen that's going to unite with the king? Then take the book and eat it up. The book isn't for anyone but the bride. He said these mysteries will only be revealed to his bride. It's the love letter. It's the stimulation of revelation. Let's all stand. Amen. It's a happy day. Brother Branham says, I just want to close with this, a final thought as we walk away. He said, does God ever change his mind about his word? He said, you can't judge God by prosperity. The world prospers. Balaam prospers by it. But brother, you judge God by his word. He keeps his word and identifies it, the truth. So remember, friend, as long as you live, don't you never forget this, God doesn't change his mind, yet he will bless. He will let you go his permissive will. Why? Because they could take whatever they wanted out of the house of the women. He never takes that option away. Amen. He never takes his permissive will, but he won't change his mind. He won't change his plan. He won't change his word for you. No, sir. You've got to change. Esther wasn't there to change the king's mind. Esther wasn't in the house of the women for sanctification and purification. She wasn't there under the tutorship of Haggai so that she could change the king's mind. She was there under the tutelage of Haggai so that she could be changed to match the king's desire. This prophet of God came to prepare a bride for a rapture, amen? He came to get her clothed in the wedding garment. He came to produce the purification word. He came for everything. Why? Because he's here to change us to match his desire. That's something the world has lost sight of. We forget who we're worshiping and start worshiping ourselves. You've got to change. You can't have God's word to match your experience. You've got to have your experience match God's word. See, that's the way you've got. You say, well, I'm a good man. God does this, that, or the other. But do you keep his word? That was the key for Esther. That was the character that the king was looking for. He comes with a book in his hand. What are you going to do about it? He's come with the revelation of the seven seals. He's opened the word. He showed us the full mystery of redemption's complete, and now it's available. You know what? He never shows you what he's doing while he's doing it. He always shows us after he's done. What about paying the price of redemption? Is he going to show us while he's doing it or after he's done? What about atonement? While he's doing it or after it's done? He come down in the seven seals, the opening seven seals, to show us what he's already done. Now my question is, this is a question only you can answer in your heart. What does that mean to me? Because he's coming to call his redeemed subjects. But how's he going to call them? He comes with the book of redemption in his hand. You mean if I'm his redeemed subject, that book of redemption is going to mean something to me? You mean if I'm the queen, it's not just, you know, sweet Jesus loves everybody, he loves you, he loves me, we're all going to heaven? No. That's not the message that calls the bride. That's not the message that clothes the bride. It's more than that. Is the message just something that your friends go to? Is the message something your parents go to? Is the message something you're here with your wife or your husband just so you don't break up a home? Is it here because these are nice people? Is it here because this is a nice building? Is that what we're here for? If that's what you're here for, then it's not for you. I don't mean to be rude, but it's not for you. If that book of life does not mean more than life itself to you, then it's not for you. If you're not willing to walk up to that mighty angel and said, give me that book. Give me my mountain. You know what? Caleb called for that mountain. You know what he knew was on the mountain? Giants. He knew there were giants on the mountain. You know what? He knew it was going to be bitter in his belly, but he didn't care. He didn't care about the fight. He didn't care about the rejection. He didn't care about the troubles. All he cared about was his inheritance. Amen. If you care about something more than your inheritance in the Word of God, something more than your position in Christ, then it's not for you. But if that book of life, if that open book thrills your soul, if that word of Haggai preparing you to meet the king and all the talk of the king and the new Jerusalem, if that thrills your soul, it's for you. If you're willing to eat all the book, then it's for you. If you enjoy while you're eating, it's sweet as honey in your mouth. It's for you. When the bitterness hits your belly and you cry out for the stimulation of revelation and get happy again, it's for you. Then you're the redeemed. You're the one that he's opened the book for. You're the reason he's come with the open the book. You're the reason that Haggai was here. It's for you. What's the evidence? Speaking in tongues? That's not the evidence. What's the evidence? Divine healing? That's not the evidence. What's the evidence? I see my name in the book. I see by revelation, not because mommy told me, not because somebody else told me, but because he called my name. When I hear it, I know it's me. When he talks about it, I know it's me. When the preacher talks about it, I know it's me. I can't explain how. I don't know how. Esther didn't know all the reasons why the king chose her. All she knows is she heard her name. And when she heard her name, everything in her life changed. Have you heard your name? Let everything in your life change. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this word. We thank you, Lord, that you've opened our eyes and we see. God, I'm just so thankful, Lord, that you chose to come my way one day. And you showed me your open book, Lord. And oh God, I could have been any kind of creature. I could have been any kind of person. But Lord, you just put something down inside of me that has nothing to do with this body of flesh. But that something inside of me, when I saw that open book, I craved it. I wanted it. There's something calling out for it. And God, that's my testimony. That's my name being called. That's my redemption. That's the voice of my redemption. I believe it with all of my heart, oh God. God, I pray if there's anyone here who's not caught that revelation, that Lord, under the anointing of the word, that you would just strike their hearts with a revelation that it's for me, that it's for me, that Esther wasn't there for Esther, the book of Esther's there for me, that Caleb's not just a cute story in the Old Testament, but Caleb's my story. Oh God, let it be real to us this morning. Oh, we just give you our lives. We ask that you would take us, you would mold us into your character, oh God. Change us, Lord, from what we are to what you want us to be. We're here to please you. Lord, we declare today we are not here to please ourselves. We are here to please you and you only, Lord. Cut us and shape us and mold us and make us to where we be nothing but pleasing to you, oh God. Let this word just knock all of the world off of us, all of our own ideas, let it fade away. And let this word chisel us out to be a bride of Jesus Christ. Oh, how we thank you, God, for redemption. How we thank you for the revelation. I pray that you'd pour out a whole barrel of the wine of revelation right now. The stimulation that makes us so happy, that makes us dance, that makes us sing, that makes us shout, that makes us act like fools, Lord. Because we've caught the revelation and its stimulation like wine. Oh, we ask your blessings, Lord, as we part and go our ways. Keep us safe. Bring us again, oh God. We love you and praise your holy name. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.